In our today's lecture, we will talk about all the typical and atypical features of our vertebra according to the regions. And every vertebra has typical features, and some region-specific vertebra have atypical features. And when I am talking about the typical features of the vertebra, by that I mean a vertebra that all the vertebra would have those features. And if I am talking about the atypical features, then by that I mean the features of a vertebra that are different from atypical vertebral features. So, before talking about the characteristics of a typical vertebra, let's look at this image. This is showing the features of a typical vertebra. And this is a view, and we are looking at the vertebra from above, means this is a superior view. And this one here is the lateral view, and we are looking at the vertebra from the side. So the first part that I am going to discuss is the vertebral body, and you can see that this is the largest and the flattened part of the vertebra. And this one will get in close contact with the other body of the other vertebra lying adjacent to it, but there will be no direct bone-to-bone contact between these two vertebral bodies. You may already know that there lies the intervertebral disc between the two vertebral bodies. This one here is called the pedicle. Before that, let's look at this feature. This is called the vertebral foramen, and when the vertebra stack together, they will form a tube, and through that tube the spinal cord will pass, and for the formation of the tube, this vertebral foramen is responsible, because when the vertebra will stack together, they will form a tube due to these vertebral foramen, and the bony parts of the vertebra will protect the spinal cord, which is very delicate. The lateral walls of the vertebral foramen are formed by the pedicle, and the posterior wall of the foramen is formed by the lamina. Where the pedicle joins with the lamina, you can appreciate a process arising from the side, and this is called the transverse process, and the transverse process is lying at both sides because there are two pedicle and two lamina. So when the pedicle will join with the lamina, the two processes will arise from each side, and we are calling them the transverse processes. When the two lamina will join together, then there is another process arising from that point, and we are calling it the spinous process. If we look at the features of the vertebra from the side, then once again you can appreciate the vertebral body. You can also appreciate the transverse process arising from the point where the pedicle meets the lamina. The spinous process that you can feel throughout the length of your spine on the skin. And this is when the two lamina will join. You can also appreciate the superior articular process and the inferior articular process in this view. The superior articular processes there will be two superior articular processes and the two inferior articular processes. The superior articular processes will articulate with the vertebra above, and the inferior articular processes will articulate with the vertebra below. Another important part is this neural arch, and it basically is composed of the vertebral foramen that we have already discussed. We have discussed about its lateral walls and its posterior wall, and we have already talked about the canal, and we have discussed that through that canal will pass the spinal cord. Now let's look at the characteristics in detail. The body, this is the broad flattened largest part of the vertebra. When the vertebra are stacked together in the vertebral column, it is the flattened surfaces of the body of each vertebra that articulate with the corresponding surfaces of adjacent vertebra. However, there is no direct bone-to-bone contact, since between each pair of bone is a tough pair of fibrocartilage called the intervertebral disc. The bodies of the vertebra lie to the front of the vertebral column. So the body is basically the interior part of your vertebral column, and it is forming the front of your vertebral column, increasing greatly in size towards the base of the spine, as the lower spine has to support much more weight than the upper regions. So there are the region specific changes, and the body adapt according to the region, and it will be larger in the lumbar region as compared to the thoracic and cervical, and it will be larger in the thoracic region as compared to the cervical region, because the lumbar region is the region which is the most weight-bearing part of your vertebral column. The next is the vertebral neural arch, and this encloses a large vertebral foramen that we have already discussed. It lies behind the body and forms the posterior and lateral walls of the vertebral foramen. The lateral walls are formed from the pairs of bone called the pedicles. Projecting from the regions where the pedicle meets the lamina is a lateral prominence called a transverse process that we have already discussed, that the part where the pedicle is joining with the lamina, there would be a lateral prominence that we are calling the transverse process. And where the two lamina will meet at the back, there will arise a process called the spinous process. These are the bony prominences that can be felt through the skin along the length of the spine. The neural arch has four articular surfaces that we have already seen in the image. There were two articular surfaces that we call the spiral articular processes or spiral articular surfaces, and there were two articular surfaces below that we call the inferior articular processes. The vertebral foramen from the vertebral neural canal that contains the spinal cord. So the vertebral canal, the vertebral foramen are responsible. Now we will talk about the cervical vertebra. First we will look at the typical vertebral features of the cervical vertebra, and then we will discuss about the atypical features of the cervical vertebra. So let's look at the typical features of your cervical vertebra. And basically the cervical vertebra are the smallest, and they possesses shorter or smaller transverse processes, and these transverse processes would have a foramen for the passage of vertebral body, and we know that the vertebral bodies will go upwards in the brain and take part in the formation of the circulus arteriosus. So here you can appreciate the transverse foramen, and you can see that the transverse processes are very small. The body is also small, and the transverse process through this transverse foramen will pass the vertebral arteries, and these vertebral arteries will take part in the formation of circulus arteriosus. This is the atlas vertebra, and we know that the atlas is the C1 vertebra, and this is basically a ring of bone, and it does not have a distinct body or a spinous process. You can see that it does not have a distinct body and a spinous process like others, and it has two short transverse processes. It also contains a transverse foramen, and the important thing is that it contains two flattened facets, these two flattened facets that articulate with the occipital bone of the skull to form the condylite joints, and at this joint will be a movement which is called the nodding movement of the head, and you will be able to move your head due to this joint. So once again, this is an atypical vertebra, and this is called the C1 vertebra. We have discussed about the typical features of the cervical vertebra. We have looked at the body, just like the other typical vertebras. It has a body, it has transfer processes, it has a spinous process. But there is a difference in the cervical vertebra. It contains the transverse foramen to allow the passage of the vertebral arteries. The atypical vertebra are the C1 and C2, and this is the C1 vertebra, which is called the atlas vertebra, and this is a ring of a bone, and there is no distinct body or the spinous process. It has short transverse processes, and these transverse processes contain the transverse foramen for the vertebral artery passage. Important thing is these superior articular facets to form the condylite joint with the occipital bone, which is allowing a movement, that is the nodding of your head. This is the C2 vertebra, which is also called the axis, and it lies below the atlas, and it has a small body and there is another projection which is called the odontoid process. And this occupies part of the posterior foramen of the atlas above, and it is held together by a ligament, and we will look at that ligament in the next slides. And the head pivots on this joint with due to this odontoid process, and with this ring, they will form the atlanto-axial joint that also permits a movement, and you will be able to move your head side to side due to this joint. Now let's talk about its feature in detail. So these are the smallest vertebra. The transverse processes have a foramen through which a vertebral artery passes upwards to the brain. The first two cervical vertebra, the atlas and axis, are atypical, means that they have different features. The first cervical vertebra, the atlas, is the bone on which the skull rests. Below the atlas is the axis, the second cervical vertebra. The atlas is essentially a ring of bone with no distinct body or spinous process, that we have already seen that the atlas did not have any distinct body or spinous process. It does not have any spinous process, it does not have any body. Okay, it possesses two flattened facets that articulate with the occipital bone. These are condylite joints, and they permit the nodding of your head. So these articular facets will form a joint with the occipital bone, a condylite joint, and this will allow you to move your head. Nodding movement is possible at this joint. The axis sits below the atlas and has a small body with a small superior projection called the odontoid process. This occupies part of the posterior foramen of the atlas above and is held securely within it by the transverse ligament. The head pivots, that means it moves side to side at this joint. So this occupies part of the posterior foramen of the atlas above, and it's securely held within it by the transverse ligament, and there is a movement that occurs at this joint, which is the atlanto-axial joint, which is the pivot joint, and you are able to move your head from side to side due to this joint. The seventh cervical vertebra, C1, C7, is also known as the vertebra prominence. It possesses a long spinous process terminating in a swollen tubercle, which is easily felt at the back of your neck. So these are the features of the seventh cervical vertebra, which is the last cervical vertebra. It has typical features just like the other typical vertebra. It has a body, it has transverse processes, it has transverse foramen for the passage of vertebral arteries, just like the other typical cervical vertebra. It has a distinct feature, that is, it has a very long spinous process, and you can feel this prominence at the back of your neck at this level. This is the lateral view of the cervical spine, and you can see that the C7 vertebra has the longest spinous process. You can count the cervical vertebra. This is the C7 that has the longest spinous process. C7, C6, C5, C4, C3, C2 and C1. So you can see that the C7 vertebra has the longest spinous process, and you can feel it at the back of your neck. Okay, so the next is the thoracic vertebra, and the thoracic vertebra, we already know, are total 12 in number, and these are larger than the cervical vertebra because it has to support more body weight as compared to the cervical region, and the bodies and the transverse processes have facets for the articulation with the ribs. Thoracic spine है आपके पास यहाँ पर, and definitely within the thoracic region we already know that there will be the rib cage as well, and interiorly we discussed that the ribs will join or articulate with the sternum, while the at the back these ribs will articulate with the thoracic vertebra. So definitely for the articulation, the thoracic vertebra would have the facets. So the just like the cervical vertebra had transverse foramen for the passage of the vertebral body, and that was their feature. So the thoracic vertebra would contain the facets, articular facets for the tubercle of the rib, and that is their distinct feature. So one thing is that the body of the thoracic vertebra will be larger as compared to the cervical vertebra. The other important thing is that they would have the body and the transverse processes would have the articular facets for the tubercle of the rib, and you can appreciate these facets here. So these are the distinct features of the thoracic vertebra. And just like the other typical vertebra, it has a body, transverse processes, pedicle, lamina, and the spinous process. The only difference is they have the facets for the articulation with the tubercle of the ribs. Okay, so this is the lateral view showing the thoracic spine. Then comes the lumbar vertebra. These are the largest of the vertebra because they have to support the weight of the upper body. They have substantial spinous processes for the attachment of the muscles of the lower back. So they have the largest vertebral body as compared to the all regions of other regions of the vertebral column, and they have a substantial spinous process for the attachment of the muscles of the lower back. So that's how a lumbar vertebra looks like. It has a largest body. It has a vertebral foramen, it has the transverse processes, it has substantial spinous process, Then comes the sacrum, and you already know that 5 rudimentary vertebrae fused to form a triangular or wedge-shaped bone, which is called the sacrum. And if you look at this bone, this is concave from its interior surface. The upper part or its base articulates with the 5th lumbar vertebra. On each side, it articulates with the ilium to form a joint, which is called the sacroiliac joint. This is the ilium of your iliac bone of the hip bone, which is a part of the hip bone, and the sides of the sacrum is articulating with the iliac bone and forming a joint that is called the sacroiliac joint. And other important part that we discussed is that its base articulates with the 5th lumbar vertebra. At its inferior tip, it forms a joint with the coccyx. So it is basically forming 3 joints. It is forming a joint with the 5th lumbar vertebra at its base, and at its side it is forming a joint with the iliac bone, which is a part of your hip bone, and it is forming the sacroiliac joint. At its end, it is forming a joint with the coccyx. Okay, the anterior edge of the base, the promontory protrudes into the pelvic cavity. This part is called the promontory, and it basically protrudes into the pelvic cavity. The vertebral foramen are present, and on each side of the bone there is a series of foramen for the passage of the nerves. These foramen at the sides allows the passage of very, very important nerves. Then comes the coccyx, and we know that the coccyx consists of 4 vertebrae that fuse to form a very small triangular bone. The broad base of the coccyx articulates with the tip of the sacrum. So this is the coccyx 1, coccyx 2, coccyx 3 and coccyx 4. This bone is also called the tail bone. Then we will look at some of the features associated with the vertebral column, like the intervertebral disc, the intervertebral foramina, and the ligaments of the vertebral canal. So let's talk about the intervertebral discs first. The bodies of the adjacent vertebra are separated by the intervertebral disc that we have already discussed, consisting of an outer rim of the fibrocartilage called the annulus fibrosus, and a central core of soft gelatinous material which is called the nucleus pulposus. They are thinnest in the cervical region and become progressively thicker towards the lumbar region as spinal loading increases. So this is another adaptation. The one was the change in the size of the vertebral body, and the second one is the thickness of your intervertebral disc. The posterior longitude and ligament in the vertebral canal helps to keep them in place. They have a shock absorbing function, and the cartilaginous joints allow them to move with the flexibility. So this is the structure of the intervertebral disc. The first point to be noted here is that it is lying between the two vertebra, and at its cross section you can appreciate an outer part which is called the annulus fibrosus, and an inner gelatinous material which is called the nucleus pulposus. So it has a shock absorbing function. The intervertebral foramina. When the two adjacent vertebrae are viewed from the side, a foramen formed by a gap between the vertebral pedicles, and they can be seen. Half of the wall is formed by the vertebra above and half by the one below. Throughout the length of the column, there is an inner vertebral foramen on each side between every pair of the vertebra, through which the spinal nerves, blood vessels and the lymph vessels pass. So these intervertebral foramen are basically formed between due to the gap between the vertebral pedicles, and they basically allows the passage of spinal nerves, blood vessels and the lymph vessels. Next is the ligaments of the vertebral column. These ligaments hold the vertebra together and keep the intervertebral discs in position. The transverse ligament maintains the odontoid process of the axis in the correct position in relation to the atlas. So this is the transverse ligament that maintains the odontoid process of the axis, that was the C2 vertebra, in the correct position in relation to the atlas. The anterior longitudinal ligament extends the whole length of the column and lies in front of the vertebral bodies. By its name, you can get the idea that it will be lying anteriorly. So it lies anteriorly in front of the vertebral bodies. The posterior longitudinal ligament lies inside the vertebral canal and extends the whole length of the vertebral column in close contact with the posterior surface of the bodies of the bones. The ligamentum flava connect the lamina of the adjacent vertebra, and the ligamentum nuchae and the supraspinous ligament connect the spinous processes extending from the occiput to the sacrum. So these are the different ligaments that you can appreciate. This is the ligamentum flavum, and this ligamentum flavum basically connects the lamina of the adjacent vertebra. Then there is the anterior longitudinal ligament, which is lying anteriorly to the bodies. You can also appreciate the posterior longitudinal ligament, and it is lying inside the vertebral canal and extending through the whole length of the vertebral column in close contact with the posterior surface of the body of the vertebra. Then you can also appreciate the supraspinous ligament, and the supraspinous ligament is connecting the spinous processes. Then you can also appreciate the intertransverse ligament that are lying between the transverse ligaments. So remember the ligamentum flavum, the anterior longitudinal ligament, the supraspinous ligament, intertransverse ligament, and the posterior longitudinal ligament. And the ligament that is basically responsible keeps the intervertebral disc close is the posterior longitudinal ligament. Next are the curves of the vertebral column, and these are also very important. You can appreciate these curves when you look at the vertebral column from the side. When viewed from the side, the vertebral column presents four curves, two primary and two secondary curves. The fetus lies curls up so that the head and knees are more or less touching. This position shows the primary curvature, which is this curvature, the thoracic curvature, and this is the primary curvature that develops during the intrauterine life. And you can see that this is concave interiorly. This thoracic curve, which is called the kyphosis, it is the primary curvature which develops during the intrauterine life, and it is concave interiorly. The other primary curvature is this sacral curvature, and this is also kyphosis. So these are the two primary curvatures, sacral
and the thoracic. Cervical and lumbar are the two curvatures. These are the secondary curvatures. This secondary cervical develops when the child can hold up his or her head after about 3 months, and the secondary lumbar curvature develops when the baby stands upright after 12 to 15 months. So the cervical and lumbar are the secondary curvatures. The cervical is convex interiorly. You can appreciate its curvature. It's lordosis. It is called lordosis, and it is convex interiorly. So is the lumbar curvature. It is also convex interiorly, and we are calling it lordosis. Cervical and lumbar are the secondary curvatures, while the thoracic and sacra are the primary curvatures, and these are concave interiorly, and we are calling it kyphosis. Last is the movement occurring at the vertebral column, and there can be different movements. There can be but limited movements. Lateral flexion is possible at the vertebral column. Rotation is responsible at the vertebral column. Circumduction, flexion, extension, which is bending forward. Flexion, which is bending forward. Extension is bending backwards. The lateral flexion, that is bending at the side. Rotation. Okay, so at the cervical vertebra, the maximum movements are possible at the cervical vertebra. You can flex your neck, you can bend your neck interiorly, you can extend your neck, means you can bend it posteriorly, you can hyperextend your neck, you can rotate your neck, and you can also bend your neck at the side. At the thoracic region, the two movements are possible, the rotation and the lateral flexion. At the lumbar region, flexion, extension and hyperextension is possible, and there will be no movement at the sacral and the coccyx joint. So these are all are the movements that are possible at the vertebral column. Functions of the vertebral column. Collectively, the vertebral foramina from the vertebral canal, which provides a strong bony projection for the delicate spinal cord lying within it. So the vertebral foramen form the vertebral canal through which the spinal cord passes. The pedicles of the adjacent vertebra form the intervertebral foramina, one on each side, providing access to the spinal cord for the spinal nerves, blood vessels and the lymph vessels. The numerous individual bones with their intervertebral discs allow movement of the whole column. The intervertebral discs, because these are the fibrocartilaginous in nature, so they also allow the flexibility to your vertebral column. It supports skull. The intervertebral discs act as a shock absorbers, protecting the brain. It forms the axis of the trunk. The vertebral column forms the axis of the trunk, giving attachment to the ribs, shoulder girdle and the upper limbs, and the pelvic girdle and the lower limbs. So that's all for today. If you have any question regarding this lecture, then you can ask. Thank you so much.